to this house that Jesus mentioned. And somehow, we begin to see ourselves as a house. Because we are the temple of God. After all, the Holy Ghost dwells in us. Amen. And we're built up upon the foundation of the holy prophets and the apostles. Jesus Christ Himself being the chief cornerstone. And in that sense, we are a house. But listen really to what Jesus said, because He never said, I will liken Him unto a house. And it really takes the Holy Ghost. You may have already seen this, but I had not until by the Holy Ghost He taught me this. Look, He says, whosoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him unto a wise man. Yes. We're talking about being made in the likeness and the image of God and bringing glory to God in our lives. Jesus said, if you hear my sayings and you do them, I'll make you to be like a wise man who built his house upon a rock. And I can hear the Master saying to Peter, after Peter had that revelation of who Christ is, He says, and I say unto you, thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my house, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Really what the Master is saying to you and I is that if we will hear His sayings, and if we will do them, we'll not be likened unto a house, we'll be likened unto Christ, who is a wise man who built his house upon a rock. Praise God, the floods descended, the rains came, the floods arose, the winds blew and beat upon that house, but it fell not. The gates of hell shall not prevail against this house. But in the end of it all, God's not satisfied with you just being a house, praise God. He said, Jesus said, in my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But God's not satisfied with that. God wants you to be like Christ. And you think to yourself, we know that. That's why we came to God. We know that. That's why they were first called Christians and Antioch. No, we don't know it. If any man thinks that he knows anything yet, he knows nothing yet as he ought to know. Amen. Could you give the Lord a praise offering tonight? Amen. I found myself telling the Lord, I don't know you. Don't raise your hand. You ever told Him that? I really don't know you, Jesus. I'm troubled. And you should be too. Because I don't know this Jesus like I need to. And I don't know Him to the degree that I should and that I'm obligated to. Praise God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the Word of God teaches us that old ministration, praise God, of the law, we haven't been long so far, I think just, maybe 35 minutes or so. And I've been preaching. Bear with me, please. But Paul teaches us in regard to that old ministry of the law of Moses, and how that was a ministration of condemnation and of death, but yet it was glorious. But he says that ministry, it had no glory because of the glory that excels. Talking about this ministration of the Spirit and of the life of Christ. And he said that even today, when the law of Moses is read to the Jews, and it's that way in all men's hearts, that veil that Moses had to put upon his face when he had come down from Mount Sinai, praise God, in communion and fellowship with God, because the glory of God was upon his face. As in water, face answered to face, even so the heart of man to man. God talked to Moses as a man talked to his own friend, praise God. And he couldn't help but that the glory of God. And that glory was just the Old Testament. It was a ministry of death that told you were dying in your sin. It gave you no remedy. It gave you no hope. It told you all that you did wrong, praise God. But it couldn't save you. And yet it was glorious. And then he had to put that veil upon his face so that they could not look to the end of that which was beyond the veil. And we know that Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. Praise God. But when that heart shall turn to the Lord, Paul said, then shall that veil be taken away, glory to God. That which separated man from seeing the glory and the image of God in Christ Jesus. He goes on in chapter 4. And he said, if our gospel be hid, praise God, is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ should shine unto them. For God, who caused the light to shine out of darkness, has shined into our hearts to give unto us the light of the knowledge of God in the face of Jesus Christ, he says. So that same God that said, let there be light. And there was light. And he saw his own image. And he saw his own reflection upon the face of the deep there by that light. Now, praise God, not as in the old times, praise God. Not as in the earth only. We still have the light by day and the moon by night. Hallelujah. But now God says, because they've sinned and because their foolish heart had become darkened, oh, thank God that he sent Christ. And he said, I am the light of the world. He that believes on me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. You don't just need that light to get you through the workday. You don't just need that light so you can understand your husband better. You don't just need that light so that you can fulfill the ministry that God's called you to. I'm telling you, God is shining that light into your heart so that he can see his own reflection, so that he can see his own image and his own glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let there be light, he said. And there was light. And we can see, if you turn with me, with this I'll close. If you stand with me, please stand tonight with me. We see the purpose of God throughout all humanity until Christ comes. That God should be glorified in his church. We see the way that we have erred and fallen short of the glory of God. And we see that God sent the remedy in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. Truly the light of the gospel has shined into our hearts. And we can see that by that, God has a creative purpose by the power of his word. Like we sing that song, create in me a clean heart, O God. He recreates the heart, takes out that heart of stone, and puts that heart of flesh in there that can respond to his will so that he can be glorified. And we see that you and I, in order to comply with God's purpose, we must be not hearers of the word only, deceiving ourselves, but when we look into that perfect law of liberty, that we not be as a natural man, beholding his face in the glass, and then we turn and we forget what manner of man we are. Amen. But rather that we look into the perfect law of liberty, being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, so that we can be blessed in our deed. Amen. That we look into the word of God as it is, as Paul said, we see darkly as in a glass, but then face to face. And he said that we're all changed from glory to glory by that same image, so as by the Spirit of the Lord, he said. As we see this image, when we meditate in God's word, we're really seeing the hidden man of the heart that is in Christ in us. We're beholding Christ who is in us. Amen. And we see that it's no longer a commandment that says you should not steal, but rather it's a promise, you shall not steal. Hallelujah. It's no longer a commandment that says you should not kill, but now it's a promise. I shall not kill, praise God, because the life of Christ is in me. I can see that hidden man. I can see the glory of God. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. It's no longer a commandment that you shall not covet. Praise God, but it's a promise. You don't have to covet anymore. Glory to God. And in seeing that, we see our responsibility. Because we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power should be of God and not of us. Amen. And with that, look now with me in Matthew chapter 22, or just listen if you want. Then went the Pharisees and took counsel how they might entangle him in his talk. And they sent out unto him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, Master, we know that you are true, and you teach the way of God in truth. And neither do you care for any man, for you do not regard the person of men. Tell us therefore, what do you think? Is it lawful to give tribute unto Caesar or not? But Jesus perceived their wickedness. Can you hear the Holy Ghost? God saw the wickedness on the face of the earth and the violence. He perceived their wickedness and he said, why tempt ye me, ye hypocrites? Shew me the tribute money. And they brought unto him a penny. And he saith unto them, whose is this image and superscription? In other words, whose face is carved on this and whose name is written above it? That's the superscription. And they said to him, Caesar's. And then he said to them, render therefore unto Caesar the things which are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's. In other words, you render to man his image and his superscription as you please, as is needful. But you be sure that you render to God his image and his name. Hallelujah. You owe God. You owe God, Christian. Hallelujah. Whose is this image? Whose is this superscription stamped upon your heart? Render it back to God. God put that there, and you owe him that image. You owe him that likeness. You call yourself a Christian. Praise God. We've got to prove our love to God. He proved his love to us, but we loved him. We love him because he first loved us. Praise God. And when they heard these words, they marveled and left him and went their way. Praise God. Tonight, we understand that all of us is frail. A man in his best state is, his frame is but dust. And we've all failed. We've all come short. But what I've made an effort here tonight to do is to demonstrate to you that we can understand what God's ultimate purpose for our lives is. And, you know, it's like the early settlers when they went out to California and Oregon. Some of them had a plan to go on a certain trail, but when bad weather would come, or they would lose wagon wheels, or their horses would get scared off, they might have to pitch a lot of things and get rid of a lot of stuff, but they kept moving westward, and they kept going forward. And they might have had to take a mountainous trail instead of going down the valley like they wished they could because it was flooded. They hadn't expected that, and their guide hadn't told them that, but they pressed on forward. I can tell you, sometimes you might get your sights focused on certain goals and certain objectives in your life. It could have been graduating college or high school. It could have been being married to that particular spouse, or being able to get a job. Or some of you have invested a lot of time and money into having a home here in this earth. Praise God. But I'm going to tell you, those are just steps along the journey. You got to look to Oregon. You got to look to California. You see what I'm saying? You got to look to the end of the trail. Jesus told his apostles, we're going to the other side. And that storm rose up, praise God, and they were fearful. But Jesus, he came walking to them in the night on the sea. Peter had enough faith to say, Lord, if it's you, bid me come unto you. I can tell you tonight, Christ is saying to you, come. He's saying, you come. I've not changed my mind. My gifts and my callings are without repentance. repentance. God still has a purpose for you. The Christ should be manifested in your life. You say, brother, I'm up in age. I served the Lord when I was young. Right now, I'm just trying to hang on. I can tell you, you need to repent. You need to repent. That's the wrong kind of attitude. God won't accept that kind of junk. God will do more with you today than he did then. Yes, we serve the Lord in our youth, but praise God, Moses was a man whose strength never abated him. He was just as strong on the day that he died as he was when he was a young man, glory to God. And I tell you, he was old. Amen. We don't have an excuse because it's not our own strength. It's Christ in us, the hope of glory. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter where you're at. Tonight, God will meet with you. I beg you to come to God tonight. I beg you to lay your heart out before him like you never have before. Forget about your past. Paul said, one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and looking toward those things which are before, I press in toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus my Lord. Tonight you're not.